Good afternoon. It is Thursday. I believe it's June 17th, 2021. And this week's Finom Group Weekly State of the Market. I am your moderator and host, Seth Golden. And quite the week. We had a FOMC meeting, rate announcement, adjustments in the outlook, maybe, kind of, perhaps. And that's kind of where we're going to start today. Given that the market had its best price action, I guess you can call it, the most intraday volatility that we've seen in several weeks now. We've been trading in a very, very tight range in the major averages. Having said that, S&P 500 has also made its 29th record high of the year, I believe. We're on pace to set a record in that sense. But we'll kick off today's and this week's state of the market with a bit of a conversation about the Fed, and I do want to keep that brief, mainly because it gets enough airtime. Like, I don't want to bore anybody to tears, and we got a lot of other stuff to get to. So with that being said, you're looking at the Fed's dot plot now. And, you know, the key here, and maybe why the market did see a bit of a dramatic pullback intraday, was it seems like more of the Fed committee members have moved forward their expectations. Here's 2023, and we've got expectations for a rate hike possibly at the end of 2022 or early 2023. So that's a bit of a shift from most of the Fed committee members formally thinking, you know, later in 2023 might be the first rate hike. With that being said, assuming Jerome Powell, assuming he's renewed, if you will, for lack of better phrasing, and he stays as the Fed chairman, I don't foresee any rate hikes ever again, quite frankly. It would take a new Fed chair and a complete shift in the dynamic understanding that rate adjustments are futile. All rates are going to zero. And this is the second time the Fed has had to drop rates all the way down to zero in a matter of less than 11 years since 2008. What's the point? And from that point, if you look at the 10-year treasury, if we're just taking rates from a 10-year treasury perspective, for each new expansion cycle, the 10-year yield fails to achieve the highs from the former expansion cycle. And that's been a trend ever since the 1980s. It's not like this just started. Ever since the 1980s, for each expansion cycle that ends, you get a recession, and then the next expansion cycle, the 10-year can't get back to the former expansion cycle highs. It is a futile effort. Why mess around with rates? Let them float freely. I think the Fed has started to understand that they have other tools for which to commit and exercise their price stability mandate, their inflation mandate through Fed policy measures. I think they've realized by now. And that's why it's, in my opinion, it's no coincidence that they took rates down to zero in 2020 to combat the pandemic recession. And the forecast for the first rate hike was way out in 2023. I don't think the Fed has any intentions to ever hike rates. I think they realize they have different tools that are more effective, and they see the trend. They recognize what I just said. The 10-year yield is going to zero. It's just a matter of time before, it's a matter of when it gets there. It's a matter of when it gets there. This is not even a forecast. You know, a lot of people like to look at this and say this is the Fed's forecast. It's not. It's basically a median sentiment of what the different Fed voting members believe should be, you know, the next rate adjustment. It's just speculation. It's speculation. It's not a forecast. Jerome Powell said as such, and he's in the last two FOMC press conferences. Dot plot is not a forecast. It's a speculative device that informs market participants and economists of their thought process, but nothing more than that. Speculative device. Speaking of speculation, welcome to our weekly State of the Market once again. This is a quote from Fred Schwed. I love that, Junior. Speculation is an effort, probably unsuccessful, to turn a little bit of money into a lot. Speculation is an effort, probably unsuccessful, to turn a little money into a lot. Investment is an effort also, which should be more successful, to prevent a lot of money from becoming a little money. I like that. Flows. It's kind of dynamic there. Speaking of speculation, right? I see this all the time. This was, you know, sent to me recently from a couple of weeks ago from one of our PhenomGroup.com members. Like, because the NASDAQ finished in negative territory for the month of May, as JC Peretz of All Star Charts notes, first down month for the NASDAQ since October. Also, Willie Delwich of AllStarCharts.com. First, they stop going up. Then they start going down. The NASDAQ, given that it was red for the month of May, the NASDAQ has stopped going up. Ergo, you know, assuming what Willie's trying to get out here, they should start going down. Speculation. Speculation. Nobody knows. The NASDAQ did indeed finish in the red for the month of May. Everyone has an opinion, folks. Everybody has an opinion. Remember that as we, you know, journey through this state of the market. Remember that as we journey through the SOTM, recognizing the NASDAQ rose roughly 3% since May 28th. It is up nearly 3% from this date, almost achieving a new record high here today on the 17th of June. My opinion, these are just some dudes. Do they have, you know, good experience? Do I even follow these gentlemen on Twitter? Yes. I follow them because I'm tracking their ideas, their thoughts, their analysis. But the reality, I don't use that. I don't use anybody's. Everybody has an opinion. The best thing about the market is that nobody knows what is going to happen next. Everybody's got an opinion based on their experience, their knowledge base, the information they're digesting. But even that doesn't, there's no predictions of 100%. There's no guarantees. Nobody knows what's coming next, folks. Education is something we do to people. Yeah, we Phenom Group, we're always in education mode, and I hope all of our members are in learning mode, because learning is something people take and do for themselves. It's a choice. It's optional. It's voluntary. You can either be learning from, you know, the different sources that are out there, at the fingertips of investors and traders, or you can be doing something very different, which is more egotistical driven. I'm better than, you know, this, or I'm better than that. I can do it all on my own. It's a choice. Learning is something people take and do for themselves. It's a choice. It's optional. It's voluntary. It's one of Seth Godin's quotes. All right, as I said earlier, S&P 500, new all-time high. I think I want to say 42.57 the other day. But it was the 29th all-time high this year. But as you can see, you know, we could set a record this year. At the current rate, the S&P 500 is on pace for 64 record closing highs this year, which would eclipse the total of 62 in 2017. There's that number again. For those of you who tune in week after week to our State of the Markets, you know what 2017 means. You remember that date as being, you know, one of the years where the maximum drawdown was less than 5%. We didn't have even greater than 3% drawdown all year long. Now, the all-time record for new all-time highs in a single year was 77 back in 1995. Another year that kind of, you know, comes up frequently when we look at breadth, we look at various studies, 1995 is in there. 1964 ranks second with 65 all-time highs in that year. Now, just keep in mind, if we get a substantial, you know, correction of sorts, we're going to be knocked way off the pace. So it all looks good until it doesn't. All right, this chart or table right here speaks to market pullback. Everybody, you know, says that the market just keeps going higher in a straight line, but that's anything but the truth. We've had, in May, we had another 4% correction, consolidation, if you will. So sell in May, go away. In the past 22 years, there have been 14 pullbacks, including this year, 4%, that began in May. Seven others happened within 2 weeks, either before or after May. So as you can see, in the past 6 years, they have been fairly mild. You know, here's 2021, 2020, 3.2%. 19, we had a 6.8% decline, you know, prior 2 weeks before May. Same thing, 2.8% in 2018, and an even smaller one here in the month of May back in 2017. So we haven't gone up in a straight. We've had three separate 4%, 4 to 5% corrections this year. On a closing basis, the deepest correction was 4.2%. We've had three of those. We have not gone up in a straight line, folks. All right, if the market heads lower this week, which I think we are down on the week, even if ever so slightly, but we still have today and, of course, Friday. If the market does head lower this week and in the coming week, it's seasonally expected to do so, and that's what you see here on the chart. You know, this is the month of June going back to 2000, so a good, you know, 19-20-year period. And basically, from the midpoint of the month, on down, you know, it doesn't look so great. Last couple of days, you start to tick higher. So keep in mind that kind of to be expected. You have quarter and month end rebalancing. And that may be part of the reason for this seasonal trend in June. But I'm sure that volumes drying up and bond seasonality also play their role in the equity market trend in June. Whoops, there we go. Here's the, you know, 10-year, this goes all the way back to 1991. This is the 10-year treasury yields. We're looking at yields. And when you see the dash line below the zero line, that means bonds are getting bought. So bond prices are going up, or the 10-year treasury is going up, but yields are going lower. So anything below that horizontal line here is treasury's yields to the downside, meaning bonds are getting bought, prices are going up. Again, that kind of fits quarter end, month end rebalancing. You know, people are buying bonds and they're kind of selling equities to a certain degree. Sometimes it depends on the year and how the market has performed going into the quarter and month end of June. You know, this year's pretty good. We're up 13% in the S&P 500. Serves to figure maybe this does come to pass. And we do see weakness in the final 2 weeks of June. We'll see. Here's another one. Post-election year, the S&P 500 is typically higher, even though its weakness is at the end of the quarter. So this is the quarterly. You know, if we take, here we start the quarter in April, May, June is the end of the quarter. The S&P 500 was higher in Q1. And is up 6.3%. Coming into Thursday's trading session, the S&P 500 is up 6.3% in the Q2 period. If we add up these candles, you only get an average of 2.6%. This is going back to 1950. April, May, June. That's the second quarter. You add up the candles. It's an average of a 2.6% return in a post-election year going back to 1950. We've already got a 6.3% return. Again, it speaks to if there's going to be rebalancing, you know, maybe, you know, investors take on some bond allocation and lighten up on their equity, like we would get it. We're well above the average for a post-election year in the Q2 period. So just saying. The S&P 500 year to date through May, we've identified this chart in the past, this study, if you will, which is kind of refresh. You know, if things do in fact get weak here, end of month, end of quarter, don't lose sight of the historical data, the quantitative data. The S&P 500 gained double digits through May for just the second time since 2000. So beyond the seasonal trends, quantitative data suggests investors should not be fearful of the double-digit year-to-date returns, but rather anticipate more gains to come, barring, of course, an exogenous event. When the S&P 500 is up year-to-date through May, greater than 10%, but less than 15% since 1950, the average return the rest of the year, the rest of the year, is 11.49%. And across all time frames, you know, 1 month later, the average return is 0.46. 2 months later, which would take us into July, you got an even better average return, and the positive rate is 80% of the time. So if you get weakness here, the end of June, it's probably a buying opportunity. This is triple witching week. We've already had futures expire for certain markets. So we're, you know, it's quad witching, but now it's down to triple witching come tomorrow, Friday session. And that's what this study here shows you. The S&P 500, June, triple witching week, options expiration day tends to have an exactly flat return. And this goes all the way back to 1982. Options expiration week for the S&P 500, an average of a 0.6%, 0.06. Like this week is supposed to be a snoozer. The week after is not good, folks. Yep. 0.33% decline for the S&P 500. Here's the stats for the NASDAQ. If we're looking at next week, I mean, pretty doggone flat. For options expiration week, down. So, snoozers. It's basically what it comes down to. Snoozers for triple witching week. Next week's supposed to be a little worse, though. Looking at breadth, as we often do here in our state of the market video, in our trading room conversation, you know, coming into, I think it was Tuesday, I was looking at the percentage of stocks trading above their 50-day moving average in the S&P 500. And we were doing this bearish divergence dance here. Like, this was not looking good. I mean, you can drive a city bus through this darn thing, right? And it only has gotten worse as the week has progressed. On this particular day, we had more than just over 61% of stocks trading above their 50-day moving average. And that's as the S&P 500 made new highs this week. It's what we call a breadth divergence. You know, the index is going this way, but breadth or the market internal is going the other way. The absolute level being at 60-61% is still good. It's not great, but it is still good. In real time, it's not terribly actionable, right? Because it's been going this way for a while, but the S&P 500 has been going up for a while. So it's not terribly actionable. It's not a timing tool. It just keeps you aware of what's going on underneath the surface. Keeping in mind the S&P 500 is a cap-weighted index. So if those, you know, mega cap and large cap names are on the upswing, but a lot of other smaller cap, lesser weighting stocks are moving down, the index can keep going higher with the large caps. But if something does suddenly hit those large caps, kind of a catalyst, if you will, fear factor enters the market, well, it's going to, you know, the index is going to start catching down to what was going on underneath the surface, you know, of those large cap and the index itself. Here's another, you know, study. Also, this one comes from Andrew Thrasher, pretty much looking at the same thing. The breakdown in the percent of stocks above their 50-day moving average does not appear to be the result of the moving average simply catching up, because over time, you know, the moving averages in an uptrend will, you know, move higher. The 50-day moving average for these stocks will continue to move higher. And as they move higher, they'll, you know, compress the price of the index, or the price of the stock will gravitate closer and closer to that 50-day moving average. And so if something does upset that stock or the index, it makes it easier to go below. But as Andrew's pointing out in this particular chart, it doesn't appear as though this is the moving average line catching up rather than, you know, the individual stocks actually catching down. Percent of S&P 500 above the 50-day moving average, as we showed before, moving this way. Percent of S&P 500 with a rising 50-day moving average. Nope. So the moving average itself has also been moving lower. It hasn't been moving up as much. So it's not the culprit. It's actually stocks are getting weaker underneath the hood of the S&P 500. Another breath study kind of showing the same thing and why we think investors just need to pay attention a little bit more to what's going on underneath the surface of the S&P 500. This particular one is the percent of S&P 500 stocks at 20-day lows. At 20-day lows has been rising. Again, stocks are actually moving lower. Why the S&P was going higher? And when we last checked on this just a couple of days ago, we had this number here. We were at this particular spike. And then it eased back down. Yesterday we had a pullback in all the major indices, and it spiked up to almost 20% of stocks in the S&P 500 were trading at their 20-day low. You know, akin to what I was saying about, you know, this, even though it was looking good on the 15th, you know, the index, what was going on underneath the surface was not, and what was happening here, you know, was a little bit of an additional cautionary signal, if you will. And then the index did. Everything got hit. The large caps got hit yesterday during the FOMC meeting. To my point, sometimes it takes a catalyst. You already had maybe small and mid-cap stocks pulling lower, but the large cap stocks were holding that house together, if you will. Yesterday, FOMC meeting kind of catalyzed and everything went down and the price got weaker as opposed to just breath. And we looked at this also a couple weeks ago. The same breath metric was featured by Andrew Thrasher recently. Here's another way, if we're just looking at technology, right? Because technology is the biggest weighting within the S&P 500. And the percent of stocks at 20-day lows. We talked about this on May 6th of this year in a former state of the market. The percent of technology stocks at 20-day lows. What happened next? Well, the S&P 500 had a bit, you know, that 4% correction where the index dropped down to its 50-day moving average. Got down to, I think, 40.56. Got down to 40.56. So that is the biggest part of the market. And back then, in early May, the percent of stocks, technology stocks at 20-day lows was rising significantly, even though the index was rising until it fell over. And then all of a sudden, we were back to the 50-day moving average in the S&P 500. That's kind of a real-time example of why we were paying attention to this week, because it was staying elevated. We want it down at these levels. You get periodic spikes, and that's okay. But we want it down at these levels, not elevated. And it's been elevated here now for the first 2 weeks of June, basically. So again, look under hood at the S&P 500. It would not surprise us. You line up those factors, those breadth indicators, with the seasonality. Because remember, seasonality is not your best guide when it comes to forward S&P 500 returns. You want to pair the seasonality data with either other quantitative data, if not, what's going on in the breadth metrics, the market internals. That'll give you a better indication of whether or not the seasonality will come into play. Now, we haven't talked about our 2010 analog in a few weeks, and that's mainly because we've kind of deviated in a big way. We came into this week with the 2021 S&P 500 28 percentage points above the 2010, which is in green here, level, right? So it's easy to say, to look at that and say, well, maybe it's no longer a factor. You know, maybe this is a time we can retire this roadmap, this analog. I would wait. I would wait until, probably July 2nd, because here on July 2nd is where, back in 2010, where this particular analog troughed. So we could still fall decently and maintain that relationship with the 2010 analog. So we'll see. We'll keep it in play until then, because man alive, right? That has been a beautiful, beautiful guide until but it does serve to recognize, investors should recognize, what catalyzed this decline was the flash crash. That's what happened here. And then you had just a lot of fear, and you had a lot of people saying, we have already come so far from the 2009 bottom. We had already come so far, maybe it just is time to take some chips off the table, right? Fear begets fear. You had that flash crash. It was crazy. I remember that day. And I remember the panic. I remember the CNBC, programming from that day. And it lasted for a few more weeks, that fear, the downturn. So, but that is the difference. We don't quite have that catalyst here today. That was an exogenous event in 2010. I've been talking about if there's going to be a deviation in this analog, it might be because of the flash crash being the black swan event in 2010. And here we are. But we'll keep it in play until at least July 2nd. Looking at the NASDAQ underneath, the NASDAQ was doing the exact opposite of the S&P 500. The stock's trading above the 50-day moving average in the NASDAQ. After troughing here in mid-May, it's been nothing but a tear to the upside. It got to almost 65% of NASDAQ stocks trading above their 50-day moving average. It's the best level it's been since basically the start of March this year. Best level it's been, and the NASDAQ itself has also been on a tear to the upside. So breadth did support the NASDAQ's move, for sure. Yesterday, it pulled back and even got below 60%, but it's actually still higher than the S&P 500 percent of stocks trading above their 50-day moving average. So again, just focusing in on breadth here for the NASDAQ, and let's not forget also the correction that we had in the NASDAQ back in March in this particular quantitative study as well. We corrected within 15 days. The NASDAQ corrected 12% from peak the all-time high to the trough level. 3 months later, let's see here. The Nasdaq has actually experienced two bouts of significant consolidation of price. The most recent price consolidation was roughly 8%. The first bout of consolidation was 12% in just 15 trading days. As outlined in the table above, fast corrections are typically met with gains thereafter. The average return 3 months after a 10% correction is 6.1%, shown right there. The NASDAQ managed a 7.8% gain after the recent 12% correction. Now, this jumps from 3 months to 6 months. So while we can't forecast dips in between today and the six-month period post the rapid corrections for the NASDAQ, the six-month returns hold an average gain of 23.6%. Look at the positivity rate, folks. So we talked about the S&P 500, the seasonality, the weakness in breadth, and potentially seeing some weakness into month end, quarter end. And that showed the probabilities of possibly being dip buying opportunities. NASDAQ may be telling you the same thing if it falls prey to weakness into the quarter end as well, given what we might expect 6 months later in returns. And again, that positivity rate, 90.9%. Kind of looking forward, as we often do, and as I get my charger here, I don't want to lose battery. Sorry, folks. Somebody stop me. This is the S&P 500. We looked at this just as a refresher last week. Percent of months in which the S&P 500 closed higher than it opened from 2002 to present. So the month of July holds a win percentage since 2002 of 68% with an average return of 1.3%. Again, this could be a dip buying opportunity if we get weak here in June. And here's the NASDAQ. Now, this is just from 2008. From 2008 to 2021, so over the last 13 years, the win rate is 100% in the NASDAQ, tech, growth. look at the average return for July, 4.2%. Quite frankly, the first month of a new quarter is typically strong. Except for January of a new year. But look at April. Second quarter, start of the second quarter, 80% win rate, 68 start of the third quarter here for July. October, not bad at 63% for the S&P 500. Man, but that from 2008 to present, 100% win rate for the NASDAQ, 4.2% average return. Tech, growth, NASDAQ, that's where it's at for July. Let's see if that holds true, or is this going to be an outlier of the year? Well, why not go back to 2002 like you did for the S&P 500, Seth? Okay, let's see here. If we do go back 20 years, akin to the S&P 500 chart previously outlined, the NASDAQ is higher 79% of the time with an average return of 2.5%. There you go. Almost 80% of the time, the NASDAQ is up in July, going back to 2002, a little bit lesser of a return at 2.5%. Like, if you're not going to take that, I can't help you. Now, we're talking about tech. If we're talking about the NASDAQ, we're talking about growth. If we're talking about the NASDAQ, we're talking about FANMAG. If we're talking about the NASDAQ. However, LPL Financial just downgraded tech to neutral as of yesterday. As of yesterday, technology valuations are near 10-year highs versus the S&P 500 index. I look at this and I see a trend. You could have said that here in 2018. You could have said that here in 2017, right? You could have said that here in 2019. Like, stop it. Like, there's a trend here. Focus on the trend. It's going up, meaning that technology valuations over time are going to be higher than the S&P 500 valuation. Here's what they say. It's a tough call. It's tough not to like technology, given the strong fundamentals and rapid pace of innovation from many tech companies. But we expect cyclical value sectors like financials, industrials, materials to fare better the rest of the year as the economy gets a reopening jolt. I get it. I mean, that kind of has worked this year. So it's they're talking more on a relative performance basis, not an absolute. We downgraded our technology view to neutral primarily for these three reasons. Reopening, valuations, which you just saw on their chart here and their rationale for the reopening there. Even though we've tempered our enthusiasm, we acknowledge the sector still enjoys solid fundamentals. Demand for technology equipment and software won't go away just because people get out more. In fact, we wouldn't be surprised to see the sector grow earnings by 40% during the second quarter on a year-over-year basis. But the rest of the S&P 500 companies may see something closer to 70% growth. So I get it. Relatively speaking, 40% is great, but relatively speaking, you know, oil may actually double its year-over-year earnings. The energy sector, so on a relative basis, I get it. The better yield is probably going to be in cyclicals. I wouldn't be selling technology based on this call, though. It's a relative performance call, in my opinion. And keep in mind, opinions. That's LPL's opinion. They're downgrading it. That's their view. That's their opinion. Just some dudes. Again, you know, I take in the information. We absorb it. We want to know what, you know, people, we want to know what the bulls say. We want to know what the bears say. We put it in the blender and, you know, we've got that information and we can see what happens with price action and who's right and who's wrong. And just recall, just last week, Tom Lee upgraded technology, especially FANG. He said in order for the S&P 500 to get to 4,400, it's going to need technology. It's going to need FANG. They've underperformed. They're probably going to go through a period of outperformance. But even last week, and even though my bias is, you know, aligned that way, my portfolio is aligned that way, it, to me, it's still just information. Last week, it was just one dude, Tom Lee. This week, it's just a different dude saying a different thing, LPL Financial and their analyst. Eyes on the market. This is from Michael Semblist of JP Morgan. And he points out, man, look at fund manager tech allocations, which are at all time low. This report came out May 24th. We're 3 weeks later. Again, what has happened to the NASDAQ? What have you seen happen with Apple go from 123 up to 132 today? What's happened to Microsoft, Nvidia, Adobe, Google, Amazon, almost $3,500 again? Everybody's got a different opinion. But when I look at this chart, I say to myself, man alive, talk about your contrarian, you know, indicator. If fund managers are dumping tech, maybe you should have been buying tech in the month of May. They were dumping it. It seems to have, you know, worked out that way. A lot of good notes here from Michael Semblis as well. And he talks about earnings for the coming quarter, and he still sees upside for the market in the back half of the year. One of the things, like I get, you know, all the time I get these questions, I get these, you know, people on Twitter and stock tweets, you know, just kind of razzing and, you know, looking at things that I tweet. And I want to give you an example really quickly. So I had tweeted out this chart of a bull market because that's what we're in, folks. It's here also, I believe, maybe somewhere, someplace, perhaps. Yeah, you know, we go through these cyclical bear markets, secular bear markets, cyclical bull markets within secular bull markets. The blue lines are your secular bull markets. Secular bull markets tend to last much longer than secular bear markets. They can last anywhere from 15 to 20 years. This particular secular bull market started in 2013. So technically, we're in year eight. We're in year eight. We're not even at the average secular bull market. So going back to my tweet, this is still a secular bull market, which may still yet have another 10 years to run. You can fight it trying to call every major top that never materializes, or you can embrace it by looking for opportunities that arrive with periodic price consolidation. Buy the dip. Buy it. Buy that dip. We're in a secular bull market. All of our buy the dip signals continue to fire and validate that type of action the investor or the trader should take. Credit spreads are at their tightest level since the pandemic, high yield credit spreads. The yield curve is, you know, almost 140 basis points, the spread between the 10 and the 10 in the 2-year yield. We're not inverted. Earnings are growing. They may grow 50% this year. So three signals. Financial conditions are at record low levels. And we're in an expansion cycle. Those are your buy the dip signals, folks. Do it in a disciplined manner. You're in a secular bull market that could have another 10 years to go. So this individual retweeted, wow, calling this a 10-year bull market is bold. That's one viewpoint. Stocks will face headwind, but long term, of course, they go up. Valuation seems stretched. What do I always say? You don't make capital allocation decisions based on valuation. They have no correlation with forward S&P 500 12-month returns. They have none. But this is just, people say it time and time again. The data doesn't lie. So he says to me, he asks me, Seth, what do you think about valuations? I feel they are pretty stretched in pockets, as always, compared to the normal. My response, in every bull market, there are pockets of excess, but the market itself being above the 10-year PE is not a gauge of forward 12-month returns. Keep in mind, the S&P 500 PE was 23 coming into 2021. Now it's 21.3. Valuations are better than the start of the year. So let's say you let that 23 PE in January keep you from buying stocks, buying the S&P 500. You missed out on 500 points, 13%, because of valuations. Markets were more expensive at the beginning of the year than they are now. We've seen, you know, PE compression here through the course of the first 6 months of the trading year. And here's your chart. I don't lie. I'm not just saying stuff. Historically, there's no correlation between valuation and forward 12-month returns. Just because we hear people call it cheap or expensive doesn't mean it has a practical use for investors. CNBC loves to tout these people talking about valuations, but here's the chart. It shows you it doesn't matter if P's are here or here. There's no correlation with the 12-month forward returns of the S&P 500. In fact, it's a negative correlation. Secondly, valuations expand over time. So they should seem high. They should. They expand over time. This chart right here, like sometimes it does actually help people to see the chart of the PE, the Shiller PE ratio, moving higher over time. It takes a long time to do, but that is the way it goes. You know, from here, if you started, we wound up here in the 90s, extremes. So it's going to take a longer time, you know, to get back to these levels. But this year, we broke the trend line as PEs have expanded since 2008 again. So PEs expand over time. You can literally say this probably for the foreseeable future. Valuation seems stretched. You can say that for the foreseeable future. And again, it has no practical bearing on, you know, what the market does. Therefore, it should have no, it should play no role in how you allocate capital or whether or not you allocate capital, I should say. So just an example. And again, if you're afraid of tech, if you're afraid of, you know, FANMAC valuations, as LPL Financial is pointing out, the difference between the dot-com period and today, information technology sector as a percentage of total market capitalization is very high. It's at the highest levels it's been since the dot-com era, but information technology sector as a percent of total profits in the S&P 500 are almost in line. Back here, look at the spread. These are the actual earnings, but this is the market cap of technology. You can't drive a city bus through this. So we have more in line valuations with what these technology companies are actually producing in profits. This is not like the dot-com era. Some notes here on, you know, what's driving, you know, this uptrend, because people are still pointing to the fact that, well, when yields have rolled over, the NASDAQ technology have done better. And, you know, we see it in real time, but there's only so much of a correction when yields are rising and people are dumping tech or dumping NASDAQ or dumping growth. They're only willing to dump them so much. And then they buy them back. And yields can only go so high so fast before, you know, people start buying bonds once again. So just a few charts that kind of outline that. And this is the Charles Schwab, they call it the quilt, which, again, just thinking of this year and so many rotations, that's why I say quite often, I favor NASDAQ, I favor growth. That's kind of what I think is the longer term opportunity. I know here in 2021, if you've owned growth, if you've owned the NASDAQ, if you've owned tech and FANG, certain FANG names, you may be underperforming. But it might be comfortable underperformance. You're probably still nicely up on the year, but you're probably lagging if you just bought energy, if you just bought the reopening trade, if you just bought value. But there's been so many rotations, like I said before. If you haven't bought tech here and there, you missed out on tremendous rallies off of lows. And information tech, January 2021. Look at what has been on the top twice, energy. Utilities has even been on the top in March. It was the best performing sector. Communication services in April, May, and from materials. Like, we've had so many rotations. So many rotations. It's hard. It's actually hard to outperform when, you know, people are moving, or I should say the sectors are the flows into different sectors, you know, from one month to the next. It's usually best to just act on local weak prices if you have a good longer term perspective. And quite frankly, longer term growth is growth. Tech is where the earnings are. Tech is where the free cash flow is. Tech is also, it's safety, it's growth. So I've been okay, you know, holding on to that, buying the Qs, buying Apple on dips, buying the semiconductors on dips, and thinking long term, if, and of course, that's what the market demands. Here's Liz Ann Saunders from Charles Schwab. The market has become less binary in terms of leadership, with macro factors having a waning influence in favor of company industry fundamentals. To use an age-old term, it's a stock picker's market. What did I say just last week? What have I been preaching for the last few weeks? We're moving out of the speculative phase of this cyclical bull market into a stock or sector picker's, trading market, if you will, to a certain degree. I continue to believe stock-oriented investors should take a hybrid approach with a focus on both growth and value factors, regardless of sector biases within growth or value indexes. Investing based on fundamentals will never go out of style, which is a good segue to how I'll close on this note. Neither FOMO nor HODL are investment strategies. Always fundamentals. Again, one of my bigger positions in the Golden Capital portfolio is Apple. I'm doing well on it because I keep buying the dips and selling the rips. Improving upon my core holding. But I'll tell you firsthand, if I had just bought the energy sector ETF, I'd be doing a heck of a lot better with that same capital allocation. Having said that, I know energy is not going to sustain this momentum, this performance, as the expansion cycle starts to age and we move from the early innings into the middle innings of an expansion cycle. The cyclical trade will have run its course. And what are people going to fall back on? They're going to fall back on the earnings growth again. The high bar that, you know, the energy sector is setting this year by basically growing 100% earnings, they're not going to be able to grow the earnings to that same degree next year. They're setting too high of a bar. So where are people going to fall back to? Tried and true. Where's my free cash flow? Where is my good double-digit earnings growth going to come from on a very steady, predictable basis? Growth, technology, NASDAQ. That's the fundamentals that Lizanne Saunders is talking about. And fundamentals will never go out of style. Be patient. Think long-term. Take your drawdown like a big boy and girl. Have a strategy, have a game plan. All right. Inflation, I don't even want to get into inflation, you know, every single week. But as I've said before, inflation isn't finding its way into, you know, eroding profit margins. So far, corporations have been able to pass along certain price increases to the consumer. Why? Because the consumer's also flush with cash. You know, the government transfer checks, and there's still more to come. You got the child care tax credits that are going to come out in July. It's also one of the reasons why we adjusted our inflation outlook consistent to the end of the year. Initially, it's the base effects that are going to last through July. So we're going to see, you know, these really outsized CPI and PPI readings at least through July. Then they're going to get, you know, less and less impactful. But because we still have another round of checks that are going to last through the end of the year, the child care tax credits, we are seeing the probability of higher inflation remaining in place through the end of this year. So a bit of an adjustment for us that we made 2 weeks ago in our weekly research report to PhenomGroup.com members. But it's also something the Fed caught up with. Like we were validated. Our analysis was validated by the recent adjustment in the Fed's inflation forecast through the end of the year. A little bit of a pat on the back. Come on. Nobody else is going to do it, right? wait, hold on.
Somebody's not me.
It had to be done. It had to be done. All right. Moving on. Again, profit margins. I mean, we're talking about all-time high profit margins for the S&P 500. The inflation's not impacting corporate earnings, folks, or profits. Here, this is also kind of mind-boggling. Why we think even the estimates for Q2, Q3, the full-year estimates have risen to above $190 a share. By the way, yes, I've been, you know, heralding that. That was my belief coming through the Q1 earnings season. But business sales rose 40% year over year in April, the latest report. No wonder the stock market is at record highs. Now, what April tells us or suggests is that Q1's 11.7% year-over-year increase in S&P 500 revenues was followed by a much greater increase during the Q2 period. Because remember, we got new checks in Q2. They came out in March. Most people started spending them in April. So Q2 revenues, I think, are being projected too low. And if Q2 revenues are projected too low, Q2 earnings are going to be found to be too low as well. The Atlanta Fed's GDP Now tracking model estimates that real GDP will be up 10.5% during Q2, placing it above the previous record high during Q4 2019, just before the pandemic. Again, here's just a different way of showing you record high quarterly net margins during this inflation period. What does this all lend itself to? Well, there's your EPS. Full year right now is at 190.39 per share for the S&P 500. $190 per share, basically. This is where I thought we'd be after the Q1 period was complete. Q1 earnings cycle was complete. All right, folks. We've got a lot of notes here from the FOMC meeting. So do check them out at your leisure. But for now, markets looking pretty darn good. NASDAQ could possibly make a new all-time high by the end of the week, if not the end of the month. We'll see. We'll see how it plays. Until next time, trade safe and join us at phenomgroup.com.